pull the mic back down here. Ken, you should know that making fun of Neanderthals is today considered a hate crime. I also got a phone call while Ken was speaking, and the NCAA thinks that $3 Sambo's thing may have been an NCAA violation. Well, you know, one of the many wonderful things about Jim Soaker is that probably every single person who ever met him thought they were his best friend. If you were lucky enough to get Jim Soaker one-on-one, though, he was actually a great storyteller. I remember him once talking to a gathering of sports writers in San Francisco in an audience that included the head coaches at Stanford and Cal, San Jose State, Santa Clara, USF, St. Mary's, when they were all still playing. He said there was a great athlete at UC Davis who was struggling academically, probably wasn't going to be eligible to play football. So he went to Chancellor Jim Meyer and asked if there was anything that could be done. After all, the kid could throw a football 85 yards while sitting down. Meyer agreed to give the student a test, a one-question test. If he passed the test, he'd be eligible to play football. It would be a question that encompassed geography, politics, and mathematics. Chancellor Meyer turned to the kid and said, "What's the capital of California?" It's a tough question. The kid thought maybe it was a trick question, so he finally blurted out, "Davis." Jim Soaker held his head in his hands, and his dream of an undefeated season went up in smoke. But Chancellor Meyer simply smiled at the player and said, "No, the capital of California is Sacramento. Davis is 15 miles from Sacramento. 15 from 100 is 85, and 85 is a passing score." And the rest is history. Well, when Ken O'Brien graduated after the 1982 season, Aggie fans wondered if anyone would ever come along to take Aggie football to such heights again. Well, Scott Barry was more than up to the challenge, leading the Aggies to a perfect regular season in 1983, his first full season as a starter, and all the way to the semifinals of the Division II playoffs. No Aggie team, past or future, dominated the Northern California Athletic Conference as did those 1983 Aggies. They beat Humboldt State 34-0, Sonoma State 42-0, San Francisco State 41-9, Cal State Hayward 42-3, and Sacramento State 52-14. In 1980, you know, I wasn't going to mention that Ken played at Sac State. You know, I thought it was a favor, and I guess it's true confessions today. In 1984, Scott again led the Aggies into the NCAA playoffs and finished his career with over 5,300 passing yards, 37 touchdown passes, and a school record completion percentage of 63.3. When Scott was drafted in the sixth round by the San Francisco 49ers, no one at NFL headquarters was surprised. Scott was the player of the year in the NCAC, first team Associated Press All-American, was inducted into the Cal Aggie Athletic Hall of Fame, and remains to this day the only Aggie quarterback ever to play in the NCAA National Championship game. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Scott Barry.
Good afternoon. Apparently I'm destined to follow Ken O'Brien for the rest of my life. The only reason I played in that national championship game was because he broke his leg the week before against North Dakota State. It's such a pleasure to be here with all of you today to celebrate the extraordinary life of Coach Soaker, especially to be here with his family, Donna, Terry, and Holly. I'm afraid I have to confess to something. I pulled a Coach Soaker. I made an adjustment at halftime. I had been kind of gnawing over the last couple of weeks how to encapsulate him as a man and what he meant to me, and I was failing at it miserably. I think I wrote a draft of something 20 times. I couldn't sleep last night. I woke up this morning, and it finally occurred to me that genius has an enigmatic quality to it, and there was something about Coach Soaker. I second everything that's been said, but there was something else about him. I'm not sure I could define it for you. It was something special. And so this morning, this actually happened. I got up, I read what I'd written, I tore it up, I threw it in the trash. I drove to Bernardo's here in Davis, our favorite meeting spot. I know it was a regular spot with a lot of guys. I got out a pen. I brought my own pen. I smoothed out a napkin, and I wrote 7 words. I wasn't planning on writing 7. They just kind of came out of me. And so if you can see on the video monitor, I'm working off of Bernardo's napkin. He wrote on many. Obviously, he was famous for writing on napkins. And the first word I wrote was play. And after I wrote it, I thought, oh, I know what that means. It means many things, because he always wanted us to play football, to enjoy it. But I remember it reminded me of the first time I met him. I was sitting at my dining room table. I was 17 years old. None other than Mike Campbell had brought him to my house. Davis wasn't recruiting me. Mike actually brought him to my house. Mike, we're in the little farming town of Walnut Grove, the Sacramento River Delta, where I grew up. Mike is a longtime resident. I'm not sure it meets NCAA standards to bring the coach to a player's house today, maybe back in 1980. And he was there for an hour. He talked. I listened. I don't remember a single word he said. I remember what I said when he walked out the door. I was standing next to my father. And I said, I want to play for him. I didn't know him. I barely knew anything about Davis. And I remember holding my breath when I said it. It's not like I had a lot of options out of high school. I had just been appointed to West Point. My family wasn't of great means. Davis was Division II non-scholarship. It would be a sacrifice for me to come here. Didn't skip a beat. My father said, okay, immediately, because he had been sitting at that table with me. And maybe it was his assuredness, his easy confidence, his manner, the way he spoke about sports and football in an intellectual way. I'm not sure that was it. There was something about him I wanted to be a part of. And so I came to Davis and played. The next word I wrote was self-esteem. I think I prospered like a lot of athletes did here at Davis because he helped build our self-esteem. Don't get me wrong, I was happy to be here and I love this school. But most of us had been passed over by a lot of schools before we got here. And he not only built our self-esteem, he grew it. One of his philosophies that I responded to, and I think a lot of my teammates did as well, was his philosophy of positive reinforcement. As he explained it to me many years later, he said, you don't have to injure someone's self-esteem to coach them, to teach them, to parent them. We talked a lot about parenting as I became a parent later in life. He said, you don't have to put them down. You don't have to embarrass them. You can actually make them feel good about themselves while you're teaching them. And so he convinced us to do things we didn't know we could do. And that made playing for him great. And as great as playing for him was, the thing I'll miss most about Coach Soaker, the thing I'll cherish the most about Coach Soaker, was my 30-year friendship with him after playing. It began one afternoon in his office. I had wandered up there at the end of the season, not quite sure what to do with my afternoons. We were chatting. Out of nowhere, he says, I quote, well, good, now we can be friends. And I remember thinking, did Coach Soaker just friend me? I couldn't believe it. I mean, he was still Jim Soaker, and I was just a guy passing through the program. And he noticed the obviously confused look on my face, and he said, paraphrasing, he said, listen, I can't become too good of friends with players when they're playing for me because I need to stay objective in case I ever need to take them out of a game. And I thought, God, I should have been better friends with him because he took me out of a game once. I took that ball and I ran with it. This idea that I could be friends with Coach Soaker, and every 2 or 3 months, I would call him, dinner, lunch, breakfast. It started with dinners at the Soaker house, and Donna was always the most gracious host. And from there, our meetings took on a rhythm where we would get together and have these deep, heavy conversations. I loved these conversations. I looked forward to them. I'm not kidding you. He might quote the Tao Te Ching. Maybe I was reading the Bhagavad Gita and I'd throw something at him. We talked about life. the meaning of life, the pursuit of happiness, what it meant to live a fulfilling life, the true meaning of abundance. We got into it, 2-3 hour conversations. And most often we ended somewhere around balance. Balance was a big deal to Coach Soaker. I remember when I was playing, when the Stanford job was hovering around, I think it was 1983, I remember sitting in his office and hearing him say, you know, the best job in the country may be the job I already have. Years later, he would say to me, the greenest grass for you may be the grass you're already standing on. You just have to open your heart and quiet your mind and listen to what makes your grass green. He told me many times, find what you love to do and you'll never work a day in your life. He never considered coaching work. I'm certain I would have never had the courage to leave the business world and pursue a dream of a life in the arts without him. I wrote possibility. So at some point during these meetings, it's my favorite part, by the way, he would get out his pen and he would smooth out a napkin. And he would start to write. And often he would draw a circle. They talk about circles a lot in the Tao. And he would describe what was inside that circle. It was a field of possibility, of infinite possibility, of self-actualization. It's where you created your own reality. And everything outside the circle, like some people have said today, we weren't going to concern ourselves with. When it came to football, I used to love this. He would draw the circle, and like rays on a sun, he would write, the weather. Everybody has to play in the same weather, he would say. The officiating, the other team. He would say, we have no control over how well prepared they are, how big or fast they are. Do they have scholarships? We have no control over any of that, so we're not going to concern ourselves with that. And he would stay with possibility. He would say, I love this when he would say this. He would say, you have to believe you could beat USC. He said that when I was playing, and I believed it. I believed anything he said. But years later, I said, Coach, come on, that's a pretty audacious thing to say. I mean, we have a guy who coached at USC sitting here, Paul Hackett. And he said to me, he said, the point isn't whether or not we could beat USC. The point is whether you believe that on a given day, the possibility exists that we could beat USC. Just like you believe on a given day, the possibility exists we could score 16 points in 20 seconds. The miracle game. I wrote trust. Inevitably, in that circle, he talked about trust. We all know trust, unity, and togetherness. Trust wasn't just an idea to Coach Soaker. It wasn't something you wrote and framed and put on your wall. He believed that if you nurtured trust within a program, between players, between the administration, between coaches, it could be this indomitable force, greater than any size or speed. My best example of trust, I'm again sitting in Coach Soaker's office. It's 1984. We're 1-1. We just lost to Santa Clara. I banged my thumb on a guy's helmet. I can't hold a toothbrush. Roger Wilkinson, who I know is here, comes in, dislocates his shoulder during the game, plays great. We lose. They want to get a freshman ready to play that week against Cal Poly. They're coming to town, a great Cal Poly team. That freshman blows his knee in a scrimmage on a Wednesday. I'm sitting in Coach Soaker's office, sulking. I think the season is over. I think my career is over. And out of nowhere, he says to me, where's Ron Costa from? And I remember thinking, what? Ron Costa was our JC transfer left tackle. And I said, Coach, I don't know. And he said, how many brothers and sisters does he have? I said, Coach, I don't know. He said, what's he studying? I'm like, Coach, I don't know. And he said, you don't know the guys you're playing with. And he said, you need to get to know them. They need to trust you, and you need to trust them. He said, I quote, if you do that, we'll win. And I remember, and that was it. And he said it like, that's the last thing I'm saying. So I got up, and I walked out of his office, and I walk into the locker room, and I happen to run into Dan Gazzaniga, our right tackle, a captain, a great player. And I said, hey, Dan, why don't you and the lineman and I get together for dinner this week? And he said, and Dan says, we already do that. And I said, hey, can I come? And he says, let me talk to the guys. And I remember my heart sank because I knew there was a problem. And so we had dinner that week, pizzas. I remember Shakey's. And we didn't talk about football. We just got to know each other. And I remember, I'll never forget the next day at practice when I walked into the huddle, everything was different. Something was different. We beat Cal Poly that week. We came from behind to beat them 10-6. We won the next seven games in a row for a lot of reasons. Obviously, we had a great defense. 10-6. Years later, I asked Coach Soaker about that. It had been kind of bugging me where he came up with this. What was the inspiration for Ron? Where's Ron Costa from? And he said, I swear to God, he said this. He said, you were coming up short on your dropbacks when we were throwing to the left, and you were drifting to the right when we threw to the right. And I said, that's what prompted you to ask me where Ron Costa was from? I said, why don't you just fix my dropbacks? He said, it wasn't a football issue. It was a trust issue. And he knew that I needed to build trust. And so I said to him, I said, well, hey, why don't you just gather up the offense and get everybody together and talk about that? He said it wouldn't have been the same coming from him, and that somebody always needs to lead from within. And I said, well, Coach, how did you know what I would do or anything at all? And he said, I quote, he said, because I needed to trust you. It wasn't something he preached. It was something he practiced. The last word I wrote was gratitude. I know we've all gone a little long here. I know it's been a long morning and afternoon, but I want to leave you, if I can, briefly with one of the last days I spent with Coach Soaker, because it was here in this stadium. We met at Bernardo's for breakfast like we often did. We got into a great conversation, one of those conversations. At one point I asked him if there'd ever been any low points in his coaching career. He said no. I said, oh, come on, 1-4. Hayward State, you're down, no. And I said, how's that possible, Coach? And he said, because winning was never that important. From breakfast, we went to the Little League fields to see his grandson, Dylan, play baseball. You've never seen a prouder grandfather. From there, as we often did, we drove to his house, the Soaker house on Kent Drive. We dropped off my car. We were going to take his car here to the spring game. As he always did, he said, let's go say hi to Donna. I always found that so sweet, that even on the guy get-togethers, he included Donna. And I always look forward to seeing Donna, whose friendship became a friend. Her friendship became an extension of Coach Soaker's, my friendship with Coach Soaker. If anyone knows a warmer, more gracious woman, please tell me. And I'm going to flip the script. Behind every great woman is a great man. From the Soaker house, we drove here to the stadium. We were driving in their little green Prius. I'm not kidding, I'm complaining about something, and he would often write me. We stopped at the stoplight right over here, and I had used the word obligation, an event I had coming up, and he said, we stopped, he turned to me, and he said, as clear as can be, he said, never do anything out of obligation. If you're going to do it because it's the right thing to do. And I knew in that moment it was the right thing to do, and I was going to do it, and I was going to enjoy it. We came to the spring game. We sat right there on the home side. And at one point, it's the first time I'd ever done that, I looked over at his name on the field. And I said, Coach, how cool is that? You get to come to a stadium with your name on it. And he smiled and he said, and in my lifetime. At halftime, we wandered over to the visitor side. We hooked up with Steve Smite, a longtime friend of his. Coach Biggs was gathered with some of his friends, and we talked football and sports, a bunch of old jocks and coaches, talking shop. And then we walked out to his car. On the way walking out there, it just occurred to me what a great day it had been. Great company, conversation, family, sports, advice. It was great weather. And I just blurted out, as I have a habit of doing, I said, Coach, what a great day. And in his understated style, we were right across each other from the top of their car. He just smiled that content smile of his and raised his eyebrows a little bit and just nodded. That is how I will remember Coach Soaker. A man with a profound appreciation for the simple things in life that when built around entire life, create an extraordinary life. This man had more impact on me as a man and a person, as a father, than anyone I've ever known. I will forever be grateful for Mike Campbell for bringing him to my house. But mostly, I'll forever be grateful for the Soaker family, Donna and Terry and Holly, for sharing your father and your husband with me all these years. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. You know, another story Jim liked to tell. Years ago, my two oldest kids were in elementary school at St. James here in Davis. I think first and third grade. Jim Soaker was invited to come speak at the school. It was a big deal for everyone. After his talk, I suggested we go downtown for lunch. But he said, hey, why don't we eat in the cafeteria with the kids? I tried to explain to him that a Catholic school cafeteria probably wasn't going to have much more than mac and cheese, fish sticks, and maybe some hot dogs, but he insisted. So we got in line along with Father Coffey, the church pastor, and right behind a first grader named Billy. The lunch lady looked at Billy and said, what will you have today? The little Billy shrugged and he said, oh, what the hell, give me the hot dog. Well, that didn't sit real well with Father Coffey. So little Billy was marched off to the principal's office, still not sure what he did wrong. They didn't get any lunch that day. I apologized to Jim, but later that day he called me and said he wanted to come back to lunch the next day to see what sort of lesson little Billy had learned. So back he came the next day, and once again little Billy was asked, what will you have today, Billy? Well, little Billy looked at Coach Soaker, then he looked at Father Coffey, and he finally blurted out, I don't know, but it sure as hell won't be hot dogs. Well, after finishing her career as one of the great Aggie basketball players of all time, Jennifer Gross is now passing on that wisdom to her players, having just completed her fifth season as UC Davis head coach. It's good that you're all sitting down, because some of Jen's accomplishments as a player are truly remarkable. During those 4 years in the mid-90s, the Aggies won 101 games and lost just 19 times, including a 29-3 mark in her final season when she served as team captain and was named a Kodak All-American. She set school records for career assists with 448, steals with 300, and three-pointers with 163, and totaled 1,243 points in her Aggie career. She went on to play professional basketball in Denmark and Italy, and was later inducted into the Cal Aggie Athletic Hall of Fame. If you've never been to an Aggie women's basketball game, you really should give it a try. It's one of the best games in town. Ladies and gentlemen, Jennifer Gross.
Thank you so much. What an honor to be here. You know, you're probably asking yourselves, women's basketball coach, now what is she doing up there with all these Hall of Fame football players and coaches? And well, I was extremely fortunate. Fortunate that Coach Soaker took an interest in our program and started to become a part of our women's basketball family. You know, there's so much that's been said here today about the kind of person that Coach Soaker was, what an unbelievable coach and mentor he was, and what a special friend he was. But there's one part of Coach Soaker that hasn't been discussed yet. Some of you may know this, others, you may be a little surprised by it. But Coach Soaker was a texter. Yes, he loved to send text messages. And I have never met anyone, and remember, I coach 18 to 21-year-old women for a living. I have never met anyone who loved to use emojis as much as Coach. Always a fun, different emoji to compliment his texts. I was actually recently looking back at some of the old text messages, that conversations that we had, and they made me smile. And so I thought I would share a few of his texts that he sent me here with you today. Rise and shine, it's game day. Throw fear and doubt out the window. Just let it all hang out. All the best to you, the staff, and the team, with a smiley face emoji and a couple of little party hats. I'm thinking like a champion. Poise, grace, the way we hold ourselves, the way we shoot the ball, the way we relate together. Let the fun begin. All the best in the game this afternoon. Smiley face emoji with sunglasses, musical notes, and basketballs. Here's a few that I would receive after a win. Nice game, Jen. The ladies seem energized. Shooting and passing were sharp. The young kids are coming on. I'm loving it. A joy to wake up this morning and see the win. Congrats to all. Fight on with a smiley face, musical notes, and the Aggie horse head. After a loss, he would send something like this. Good thing about mistakes is they can be corrected. Hope springs eternal. Smiley face with a bouquet of roses. He'd say, stay the course. Love you and the team. Good things ahead. Basketball emoji with blue and gold hearts. And then, you know, just the occasional random midweek text saying, hey, free for coffee? Let's reminisce about life being good. Sunglasses emoji with golf clubs and palm trees. Every text I received from Coach was positive and uplifting. He reminded me to enjoy the moment and to savor every win, to stay focused on the things that I can control and to let everything else go. You can imagine my surprise in early December, a month after Coach had passed, that I received a text message. I looked down at my phone and my eyes focused quickly on the name Soaker. You can guess my heart was pounding a little bit. And as I looked a little more closely, I saw that it was not from Coach, but from Donna Soaker. After a nice article in the Enterprise about our basketball program and our family, Donna texted, Jim is smiling down on you, Joe, and the team with a smiley face emoji and a big heart. No wonder they were so great together. As you know, we've talked a lot about Coach as a Hall of Fame football coach. Although he did play basketball, you know, he wasn't a basketball coach, but he had an eye for the details. It didn't really matter what sport he was watching. He was tuned in. He was kind of notorious for sneaking up into the pavilion and watching practice with Gary Pearson, and they would just sit up there and observe. Most of the time, I didn't even know he was there. He would just kind of, like I said, sneak in. And he would just, he would pick up on so many things. And we'd sit together after practice. And it didn't matter if it was a great practice or a rough one. He would always point out the positives. He would give some observations, but really he would just listen. He'd never tell me exactly what to do. Instead, he would raise questions, challenge me to think about something just a little bit differently, and ultimately just bring a really unique and helpful perspective to every situation. And at the end, he would always remind me that all you can do is what you can do. I was really fortunate. I had the opportunity to play for some amazing coaches myself and work with some great coaches too. And I learned so much from them. But I was given this incredible opportunity when I first took over as the coach here at UC Davis 5 years ago. And I ran into Coach Soaker at a Hall of Fame event, and we got to chatting, and he said, you know, we need to grab coffee next week. And that coffee started a friendship that I treasured. And, you know, I just had an opportunity to learn his unique perspective on coaching and on life. He not only helped me to strengthen my own coaching philosophy, but he became a dear friend. A friend who invited my family over to his home over the holidays to spend time with Donna and him. A friend who took me out to the range to hit golf balls and teach me golf because he said that as a head coach, I needed to be able to play in charity golf tournaments. A friend who would come and speak to my staff and team regularly and remind them about the joys of being an Aggie and enjoying the sport that we love. The hardest part, I think, for me is that I still feel like I had so much to learn from him. You know, we were just getting started. Things come up every day that I want to discuss with him and that I want to get his opinions on. It's hard not to have him as a sounding board, but I just try to really, really appreciate the time that I did have. And oh my gosh, was he grateful with his time? Excuse me, was he generous with his time? I just, we talk all the time about, wow, he's coming to all these practices and sitting with us and sharing with us and talking with us, and how fortunate we were. He really did become a big part of our women's basketball program. You know, he came to all the home games. He would come to the local games at Sac State, at San Francisco, to support us, to support our student athletes and our staff. You know, nothing made me smile more than looking up and seeing Coach Soaker in the stands. I'll tell you this, his words will continue to motivate and inspire us, and our student athletes will into the future. And I do really quickly want to thank my team for coming out today and a lot of the other student athletes that are here, because I think it's so important for all of you to hear about this man. And you see, you know, we come to football games and we see Coach Soaker Field, but to really learn, what was he about? And I know for me, as I mimic his words and tell stories that I've heard from him, for you guys to know, you know, where true Aggie pride got its start, you know, and he was such a special person, not only for this football program, but for our entire athletic department. And we need to continue to remind our student athletes what he was about. And if we can all continue to coach and play the manner that Coach Soaker did, we're going to be very, very successful into the future. Lastly, as I mentioned, I enjoyed a lot of texts with Coach over the past few years. And I think if I had the chance to send him one final text, it would say, thank you for your guidance. Thank you for your generosity and your time. Thank you for your positivity. And thank you for believing in me. Smiley face emoji with blue and gold hearts, golf clubs, and palm trees. Thank you.
Thanks, Jen. I'm trying to convince Jen to give our seventh grade basketball star, Amy, an early scholarship. Haven't succeeded yet. You know, I told a story about the Davis kid that needed the special test to get into UC Davis, that Sac State had a similar problem with a kid from Esparto. And Coach went to President Girth, and same thing, the head coach, and he said to the president, says, yeah, I'll give him a test. They do that at Davis. I'll do it here. And he sits the kid down and he says, just gonna be one test. You said you want to be a math major, so here's the test. What's 2 + 2? Kid doesn't flinch. He says, 4. And the coach jumps in and says, give him another chance. Well, we should let you know, all the players that are here, under the scoreboard afterwards, Karen Froland's going to be taking pictures, various, whatever, of yours or mixed yours or whatever, what you guys want. But under the scoreboard after we're done here, there will be pictures. Well, no dedication and no tribute to Jim Soaker would be complete without hearing from Jim Soaker himself. And I'd like to share with you his own words at the dedication of Jim Soaker Field on October 13, 2007. Ladies and gentlemen, as I stand on this playing field in this wonderful stadium, I can tell you that I'm a very proud man. As I look back over the past 40 years, I can see the hundreds of players who chose to come to this great university. Players who committed themselves to be the best they could be, both in the classroom and on the field. They came from all over California. They have gone into the world as leaders in their field. When they left this university, they left a legacy of achievement that stands in the halls of South Bend, Indiana's College Football Hall of Fame by winning 20 consecutive conference championships, more than anyone in the history of American football. They have left a record of 37 consecutive winning seasons. They have left a legacy of Aggie pride. How proud I am of them. How proud I am of the students that followed and committed themselves to want to compete with the best of the best in Division I. The students who voted to build this wonderful stadium. How proud I am of all the coaches that worked with me. How proud I am of the many, many great fans who have followed these Aggie teams for so many years. Thanks to my family, Donna, Terry, and Holly, for their patience and support over many years. Those are the words of Jim Selker in 2007, a man who loved the game, he was a man who loved the game, he loved his players, he loved teaching, he loved coaching, he loved UC Davis, and most of all, he loved his family. Well, Mike Campbell has been a friend of Jim Selker and the Selker family for a long, long time. Mike graduated from UC Davis in agricultural economics, earned a master's from the Stanford School of Business. After studying at Stanford, Mike was honored as a White House fellow serving in the Chief of Staff's office at the White House. After farming with his family in Clarksburg for 10 years, Mike returned to UC Davis as assistant dean in the College of Agricultural and Environmental Sciences. He was recruited in the year 2000 as an associate vice chancellor at UC Merced, helping to get the University of California's 10th campus off the ground, something he describes as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. He returned to UC Davis as executive director of the Seed Biotechnology Center after he learned that UC Merced does not have a football team. If I listed all of Mike's awards in a wide variety of endeavors, we'd be here well into the evening. Among his major awards, he was named Young Alumnus of the Year by the Cal Aggie Alumni Association in 1978, received the Award of Distinction from the College of Agricultural and Environmental Sciences at UC Davis, and perhaps most importantly, he is past president and co-founder of the River Delta chapter of the Cal Aggie Alumni Association. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mike Campbell.
I think it's calmed down. Bob and I were classmates here. I used to tell Jim I didn't graduate with honors from Davis. It was just an honor to graduate. If this was a normal Saturday in Jim's life, he would have already been to Pete's for an early morning coffee, returned home for breakfast, completed his walk in the Arboretum. He might be mentoring a student right now, on his way to having lunch at El Macero, and then playing golf with friends. Heading home, he would have cleaned his barbecue and gotten ready for a dinner with friends and family. While he watched Dylan hit plastic golf balls in the backyard. At no time would he have complained that he was dying of cancer. However, this is not a normal day in Jim's life. This is, in fact, one of the greatest days of Jim's life. I really can't believe he isn't here. He would never miss a party like this. He would have loved today, and he deserves it. In preparation for my talk, I interviewed a number of Jim's close friends. Friends that were not going to be on the stage and not going to have the honor that we all had today. In my interviews, I asked two questions. What is your favorite memory of Jim, and what will you miss the most? I've used his friends' answers, plus my own, and information that Jim shared with me over the 44 years that we knew each other to prepare my remarks. Jim spent his first 2.5 years on his family's farm outside Oklahoma City. Today, that farm is a housing development called Selker Hillside Estates. In 1941, his mother and father sold the farm and moved his family to San Francisco. His older brother, John, was 5 years old at the time. Living in the Sunset District, the playgrounds, John and Jim's playground were the parks, streets, and beach of San Francisco. He would talk about running through Golden Gate Park, going to the zoo, playland, and staring up at the Cliff House when he was standing on the beach. He played Pop Warner football for the Les Vogel Chevrolet Power Gliders. Can you imagine what their mascot must have looked like? His lifelong close friend, Don Oldham, remembered seeing Jim play as tailback when they were 12 years old. Jim would talk about playing before the games, before the 49er games at Kezar Stadium. 6 years later, he and Don were playing together in college. He talked about caddying all day with his brother John, first at Lake Merced and then later at the Olympic Club. He played in his first San Francisco City tournament when he was 14 years old, and he won his first match. At Washington High School, he was their first four-year letterman. Four sports letterman. Then he had to decide, was he gonna go to Berkeley and play for Pappy Waldorf? Or was he going to go to San Francisco State, play for Vince, or for Joe, Verducci, and play in the backfield with his brother John? It came down to who would get him, which coach could get him the best job during the summer. He spent the summer digging trenches in San Francisco. And that fall, he lined up in the backfield with his brother John at San Francisco State. I wonder what Cal gave him as a summer, offered as a summer job. It was at San Francisco State that he met the love of his life, Donna. Jim told me a number of times that he and a friend snuck into Kezar Stadium to watch the 49ers play. In talking with Dick Logan, I found out how they got in. They had a scheme where they put on their white lab jackets, lab coats, and waited for the ambulance to arrive outside the stadium. As they opened the gate for the ambulance to enter, on one side was Don, or excuse me, on one side was Dick, and on the other side was Jim, and they walked in with the ambulance together. And then they would stand behind the 49ers bench. That worked well for four home games in a row, until Joe Verducci, who moonlighted as a scout for the Chicago Bears, was scanning the 49ers team with his binoculars and saw Dick and Jim. That ended their very promising medical career. During Jim's year, or senior year, he was selected as the Northern California Intercollegiate Back of the Year, nationally as a Little All-American, and he was drafted by the San Diego Chargers. Not a bad year. When he returned home from a wonderful trip to Europe with his friend Joel Levin, he decided to skip professional football and enroll at San Francisco State in order to receive a master's degree and to start his coaching career. In 1961, he and Donna were married. And in 1965, they headed for the University of Utah so that he could earn a doctorate in education. Driving in their Volkswagen Bug, Terry was sitting in the back seat. 2 years later, she was joined by Holly in the back seat. When my second daughter was born, I called Jim and said, "I now have two daughters." And he told me, "Daughters are the best." He was right. Jim wrote his thesis on what made seven of the top collegiate football teams in the United States outstanding year after year. As part of his investigation, he attended an athletic event and met UC Davis athletic director, Chuck Korvasic. After a short conversation, Jim was offered the opportunity to come to Davis and be the coach of the linebackers, the defensive backfield, and also coach the JV team, JV baseball team. 3 years later, at age 31, he was selected as the head coach of the football team, and that's when most of our memories begin. When I asked the question, favorite memory, the first response with everyone was, I have so many. My first interview were with teammates Bill Cochran and Ron Vanderpool. They both agreed that the lessons that Jim taught them had lasted a lifetime. And every time they saw him, he took immense interest in what they had achieved and accomplished. The miracle game against Hayward, of course, was mentioned. 16 points in 20 seconds. And I have to ask Diane Biggs if Bob is that quick around the house and can get that much done. Mike Murawski mentioned the Reno game. He said both Jim and Bob Foster had perfect game plans. The amazing electricity in the stadium, he remembers, and he thinks that night, the Aggies could have beaten any team in the United States. Bob Warren and Dick Larkey both mentioned the fifth quarter huddles at the faculty club. Win or lose brought the coaches, the parents, and the fans together. John Patella mentioned that for years he attended the Bay Area Football Scholar Athletes Dinner in San Francisco with Jim. Top scholar athletes from around the Bay Area were introduced and announced what university they planned to attend. Non-scholarship UC Davis was an equal to any team in the Pac-10 and the Ivy League. In some years, we had the most honorees committed to UC Davis. Nick Alexander, who lost his father as a young man, remembered Jim as a father figure in his life. Joe Tupin mentioned the preseason barbecues in the Soakers' backyard with coaches, players, parents, and fans attending. Several people mentioned traveling to San Francisco with Jim and visiting some of his favorite haunts, like Westlake Joe's. Reno Cruz mentioned that he and Jim were having lunch at John's Grill when the waitress surprised Jim by asking him, "Aren't you a famous football coach?" Jim told her that, yes, he did coach football. And she said that she'd seen him on TV. Reno said that Jim was feeling pretty good at this time, by this time, until she mentioned that she knew that he coached at Notre Dame. Reno privately called him Lou for the rest of his life. Ivan Franks mentioned Jim taking him to a coaching clinic where he and Bill Walsh were the instructors, and the way he felt as he stood between Bill Walsh and Jim and those two great football minds. Betty Lewis remembered Jim doing the eulogy at Dick's service. Lou Montford's memory was of Jim walking hand in hand with Dylan down the fourth fairway at El Macero. Both Tom Slater and Loyal Miner remembered what an honor it was to play football for Jim, and an even greater honor to be his friend. Pete Dolan's greatest memory was the two of them watching their grandchildren grow up together. Joni Rubin, Dave White, and Gary Pearson, all member of the Pete's Coffee Posse with Jim, each remember their great conversations early in the morning with Jim. Elliot Rose mentioned skiing in a snowstorm with Jim at Mount Bachelor. Kim and Nancy Stevenson told the story of attending a UC fundraiser with the Soakers. Kim and Jim had decided they were going to buy a cord of wood. As the bidding went higher and higher, Kim said to Jim, "Who's that bidding in the back against us?" Jim calmly responded, "It's your wife." Bob Silva remembered Jim being an outstanding teacher and psychologist. Doug Anderson remembered Jim recruiting his son in a very low key, very efficiently, away from Stanford. Phil Swimley mentioned Jim's mentoring of his grandchildren, his great kindness, and how sad they were to learn of Jim's death. Judy O'Sullivan and Clay Sigg both mentioned that Jim started off mentoring their sons and later mentored them. Steve Smythe mentioned Jim coming to his home and the two of them having a Manhattan or a lemon martini in the backyard. Steve and Rose have invited all of us over to their homes after this celebration. Everyone that I interviewed mentioned Jim's one-on-one conversations and how important they were. And what they missed the most is Jim, his presence, his kindness, and his love. My favorite memories were standing on the bridge with Jim on the 18th hole at St. Andrews last July, and his determination to be part of Dylan's life as long as he possibly could. Jim was devoted to his family and his friends, UC Davis and the Davis community. He never stopped being a legendary mentor and coach. He was a gentleman who possessed great dignity, graciousness, generosity, humility, and wisdom. His determination to live as long as possible was an inspiration for all of us that knew how sick he was. Jim gave all of us a lifetime of wonderful memories. He was the golden boy in a golden era. Success followed him everywhere. We are all blessed that he played such an important role in our lives. Donna asked me to thank all of you for being here today and for your kindness. And a very special thanks to Teresa Gould and her team that put all this together. This has been a wonderful celebration of Jim's life. He deserved it. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you to all of our speakers. I knew this was going to be a very special day, and just to be a little bit personal for a minute, I've been getting hand signals from my family in the stands. My son Ted, my oldest son Ted, who lives with his wife and three boys in Redwood City, and now they moved to Half Moon Bay. While this event was going on, his wife gave birth to a baby girl. I know they have a first name picked out of Ella, but I'm going to call him when we're done here and say that the middle name has to be Soaker. You're all welcome to come down on the field after the game. There's also up in the Bruce Edward Club Room and on the concourse, there's snacks and drinks. And that will all begin when the Aggie Banda finishes playing Aggie Fight. Thank you all for coming. Go Aggs.